So first thing you need to do when you're starting a food plot strategy is determine where you can plant, and if you're able to plant, whether it's a CRP farm or stuff like that. Some CRP programs, you're not allowed to plant food plots, so you got to make sure you're staying in compliance with that. Or if you're leasing, if it's a landowner, make sure it's good, or make sure you're not violating any codes or anything like that. So once you get to that point, let's get a soil sample. Everybody needs to do a soil sample. Whitetail Institute has a real easy soil sample bag. You go, I think it's $8 or $9. You throw a couple chunks of dirt in there, send it off, and they get you a report, email your report in a couple of days. Awesome. That's who we use all the time. Even with our local farm co-ops, I'd rather use the Whitetail Institute soil sampling because they have been real good. So then I'd let you know whether you need to amend the soil, whether you need any fertilizer or lime and things like that. Then you could start on that program. And it definitely tells you what crops will grow better on that soil. So that's the best place to start, whether you want to go with a perennial type Whitetail Institute clover, or whether you want to go with annuals and the cereal grains, Oats Plus or winter greens or anything like that. It'll let you know what you need to do to make that plot productive, because who wants to pay for a bunch of seed that won't grow? And really, your soil amendments are where you got to start. You got to figure out what you need to make that grow. In the Whitetail Institute soil sampling packet, it'll ask what you intend to plant, and you could list several things in there. So if you intend to plant clover or corn or cereal grains, you can put that on there, and they will know, and they'll make the recommendations based on all what you want to plant. And every recommendation is going to be different, because every plant that you want to plant requires different nutrients to be able to grow to sufficient growth and be attractive to deer. We plant food plots every year, some sort of grain, either corn or beans, for our late season hunting, and we always plant green plots. Now, I always spruce up our green plots. We plant a lot of Oats Plus. We do some brassica plots with Imperial Whitetails, tall time tubers and winter greens. So typically, the Whitetail Institute products don't carry crimson clover, but we've worked with Dr. Harper with National Deer Association, and he's been really instrumental in helping us develop some good food plot plants. So crimson clover, we put it in almost every cereal grain plot, the Oats Plus plot, because that clover grows fast, is very attractive, attractive even in a late season. Now, it's an annual, you got to plant it every year, but it has been one of our best food plots as a whole. So we have that crimson clover mixed with some sort of cereal grain, primarily the Oats Plus brand. One of the biggest mistakes landowners make is planting food plots where it seems convenient, rather than actually having a strategy. Okay, here's bedding, travel, destination food sources, and we're going to plant food plots in between and be able to structure some movement. They just think, okay, I've got an open field, or I've got a corner somewhere here, it's a convenient place for a food plot. Generally, the worst case scenario, sometimes they work, but generally you want to come up with a plan. You want to look at the property, know where your deer bed, where they're going to in the evening to feed, or where they're coming back from in the morning after feeding, and be able to establish some sort of plan. Okay, I'm going to plant a food plot here because they're going to stage here before they go out and into the big fields for the major nighttime feeding. So we'd like to plant our greens in the bottoms where there's a bunch of moisture, and our grains on top. One, we're big, love to hunt late season, so getting into a bottom field with a grain field, a standing bean field, or a cut corn field is pretty difficult when the leaves fall off, because a deer can bed on the side hills and see you from the side hills. So I prefer to keep those on the top so we can slip in late season and not be coming over a hill and being exposed. But during early season, the green plots in those areas work great, because you still have leaf cover up until, especially in the Midwest, until sometimes mid-November. So you have leaf cover to be able to slide in and out of blinds and stands. So that's why we prefer to plant our greens in the bottom and our grains on the hills, so we can slip in and out of stands. Access means just as much as what you're planting, to be honest. Every time we're setting a stand or a blind, one of the biggest factors we're taking into consideration is entrance and exit. I love to hunt the same stand or a same blind multiple days in a row, sometimes 2-3 weeks in a row, every time I get a chance. So entrance and exit is critical to that. I don't like to be in a destination field where deer are going to be there at dark. I like to be in those pass-through fields, those smaller food plots on the way to the destination fields. And then I always like to have some sort of cover on the way to that, whether it be down a field edge where you can slip in and out, where deer, where they're bedded, can't see you come in and out. Late season is a little bit more difficult because you have less cover on the trees. So you got to be really careful then in late season. You got to make sure you stay on the ridges, don't be coming over the ridge into a bottom, because deer will pick you off pretty quick. But that entrance and exit is probably the biggest determining factor, one of the biggest determining factors in where we place our stands and blinds, because we do hunt several days in a row at times. So occasionally we'll cut some brush to create a screen, especially blinds. A lot of blinds are out in the center of field. Of course, you see that quite a bit, but we've gotten to a point where we're pushing them closer to the timber edge, and literally you'll walk up a trail right to the ladder, get in the blind, same way at the tree. We try to stay low in a creek or a ditch, even in the field, open field, for coming across an open field. Try to stay in a low spot. Don't highlight yourself, skylight yourself. Stay in a low spot, slip in, be able to slip up and down that ladder to a tree stand or a blind, without being exposing yourself the least amount that you expose yourself. And to the point where we put our ladder sticks, our climbing sticks, on the back side of the tree where we think the deer are coming from. So if deer happen to be in the field, there's been several times that we've been able to get to a tree, get up in a tree with deer actually out in the field within 70 or 80 yards of us, only because of our entry and exit strategies.